delighted that you're here today. And I want to talk about living selfless in a selfie world. Selfless in a selfie world. And our passage that we've been looking at and want to make this series about comes out of 1 Corinthians chapter 13, known as the love chapter of the Bible. And I just want to read part of it and highlight the words that I want to cover today. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. And then here are our words today. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor. It is not self-seeking. No boasting, no pride, no dishonoring, no self-seeking. Pretty much sounds like our culture, right? Right? Actually, what's sad about that description is Paul did not write those words for the outside community. Paul wrote those words to the church. See, apparently at that time, people had invited Jesus into their life. They had found forgiveness and grace, but their behavior towards one another still needed to catch up with the change that had happened on the inside. And so you could call it Christians behaving badly. And so 1 Corinthians 13 needs to be written to bring some corrections to the people on the inside of church. And so what I want to highlight, though, is these words are not just church words. Today is not just about how we talk to one another inside the walls of church or what you say to other Christian people. It is what we're supposed to take outside the walls. If you're a follower of Jesus and you care about God's word as you should, then this is not just a Sunday book for church. It's a sacred book for life, which means it goes into Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday and every other day that ends in Y. All right, goes into all of the days of the week. We take it with us where we go. And then just let me remind you, Paul wrote those words in an environment that was toxic. You know, sometimes we feel like, you know, we're living in some of the worst times. Well, I understand kind of the sentiment. I don't know really if there's ever been a hostile time like it was in the first century when Rome was in charge. There were things about that culture that were so violent, so degrading, so humiliating, so might is right, that for Paul to come along and write these words to a group of Christians, it must have felt so impossible to live them out. And yet, I want to ask you to consider this. What if, in fact, in the grand scheme of things, the way God designed the world is the better way to live? What if actually, go with me on this, what if humility is better than arrogance? What if it'll actually take you further? What if serving others will actually take you further even in our culture than living a self-serving life? What if that actually is one of the ways in which life was designed to work and it works better? I'm not saying that wrong behavior can't win. I'm not saying that people that do bad things can't get ahead. I'm just saying at what cost and for how long. Because there's a limited time frame for anything that's based on the things of the world. Can I remind you that the Roman Empire that was in charge of the first century, in all practical purposes, does not exist to this day? The city of Rome does, but if you go there, you go there to look at the stuff that no longer is alive. It's just history. It died years and years ago. And yet the church, born out of that time period, is alive and well around the world. And so, well, hello. I don't know if you heard that in Alamo, but it was a nice little chime. I don't think we have new sound effects for the sermon, but it was appropriate right there. What I want to suggest, though, is oftentimes what happens, and I pastored down the Bay Area for a long time, and years ago, I felt like I was seeing people succeeding one-dimensionally. You know what I'm saying when I say one-dimensional? It's that they would succeed at work, and so their career would be going well, but their relationships would be a mess. That he could hit the softball over the fence, but he can't find time to date his wife. That she has time for the gym, but no time for God. You see, you succeed one-dimensionally, you succeed maybe even for a season, but then the season ends and the success that you had doesn't last because it wasn't based on what was designed to last. And so God's plans are better than the plans of the world. And so you might be coming into a series like this, whether you're online or whether you're in one of our environments today, and this is all new to you. The Bible is new. The thought of following Jesus is new. Well, what God did was give us his word in writing so that we could not only learn about him, we could learn about his ways. And I want to take you to an interesting passage that I think is a complementary passage to 1 Corinthians 13, and it's Mark chapter 9. And it involves real people, and I love the fact that the Bible has people that personify the principles of the Bible. They either illustrate it or they become examples of people that need to learn it because how they're doing it isn't really working, and that's really what this story is like. And this is Mark chapter 9, but I want to start in the middle of the story, and I'll tell you why in just a moment. But it says, when they came to Capernaum, so this is Jesus and his 12 disciples, and Jesus was in the house, he asked them what they were arguing about on the road. But they kept quiet because on the way, they had argued about who was the, what's the next word? Greatest. These are the 12 guys Jesus has picked to entrust to them the message of salvation that's supposed to go to the entire world. And they're arguing about who's the greatest among the 12 of them. And I don't know if you see that as sad or funny. I don't know if this is a tragedy or a comedy right here, but aren't you glad God put that story in the Bible? Aren't you glad you're not in that story? That at that moment, this was not the spotlight on your life, because all of us can do this. And oftentimes when you see the disciples depicted maybe on TV or in movies, a lot of times they look like 30-year or 40-year-old men. They were more likely like in their 20s, maybe even late teens, 18, 19 even. And so think a little bit more like high school, college, trash-talking boys on the basketball court. Keep in mind there's brothers among the 12 and how brothers can go at it, the pushing and the shoving. Think about the fact that there's a guy named Simon the Zealot. What did you have to do to get that added to the end of your name? The Zealot. And then Matthew, the tax collector, former tax collector, you didn't get that job unless you knew how to put yourself first at everyone else's expense. And then there's these seasoned, weathered fishermen. I mean, it's an interesting group of people, and they're arguing among themselves who is the greatest. Now, Mark doesn't actually elaborate on the whole scene, but as I said, I took you to the middle of the story. Can I tell you where that argument began? Because here's how the day started. Back up to verse 30. They left that place and passed through Galilee. Jesus did not want anyone to know where they were because he was, what's the next word? Teaching his disciples. So today wasn't about the crowds. It wasn't about the masses of people. It was about his 12 guys. Now, we don't know exactly what the morning looked like, but as Jesus would often do, he would actually do a little road trip, and they would go from one place to another, and he would teach while they walked. And so these 12 are in a class. I want to suggest maybe it was Leadership Strategies of Jesus 101. And he's talking about, you know, what life looks like when you follow him. And at some point, all that Mark does is really give us the course objective in one sentence. And if you're, you know, in college or you remember your university times, oftentimes professors would write what the whole objective of the entire semester would look like. And in that, I think it was this. Jesus said to them, "The Son of Man is going to be betrayed into the hands of men. They will kill him, and after 3 days he will rise." Translation, boys, my leadership plan is not at all what you're expecting. Because Rome had taken over the then known world by force. And the Jewish people who were now under their domination believed that the Messiah would come and do the same thing back to Rome that Rome had done to them, that the Messiah would come in with tremendous force, take out Rome and establish his kingdom by power and might. And then Jesus is talking in terms of, oh, by the way, they are gonna kill me. It's okay, I'll rise again in 3 days. They don't understand what he's talking about. But perhaps all morning long, he had been talking about servant leadership. How it's not about how you exalt yourself, and it's not about positions and posture and followers and all kinds of things, Perhaps it's about serving others. Their response to his lecture is summarized in this sentence. But they did not understand what he meant, for they were afraid to ask him about it. Did I say that these were the guys that Jesus was going to entrust the salvation of the whole world to? They were too afraid to ask a question, but they were not too afraid to change the subject. So I don't know what happened. You know, Jesus says, hey, why don't you guys break? Why don't you just talk among yourselves for a little while about what I've been teaching you? And I don't know how it really played out, but it's like, on that subject, I don't know what Jesus was talking about, but I'll tell you this, I'm better than you guys. If they had cell phones, they'd be pulling out their social media. Like, I have more followers than you do. Look at my TikTok video. It got more you know, watches than yours did. And here they are posturing back and forth, talking about who is the greatest. Not who is a great person, but who is the greatest. Do you know there's a difference between the two of those things? Because it could be argued that Hitler was great at something. He was great at mobilizing and moving people in a particular direction for a particular outcome that was evil. He was no means great. History would call him a monster, but he was great at something. In this time in history, it was Herod, later known as Herod the Great. I don't know if he added that to his own name. I think that would have been interesting. I'm so great, I'm just gonna add it to my name. Now, from now on, call me Herod the Great. I don't know if history put it on him or he put it on himself, but somehow he was known for his great buildings, his ability to actually accomplish certain things. He was great at things, but he was not great. He was evil. And even in Jesus' time, you know, he was the one that was going to kill all of the young babies out of fear that the king would arise out of the Jewish population. And so here's not a great man. When we were in Israel, we had our tour guide, and she would always refer to Herod as Herod the not so great. I loved it. But he was great at something. But here are these guys, and they're caught up with the ways of the world. They're not talking about how to be great. They're talking about what great position they should get. They're talking about how they could be great at something and ahead of others because of how great they are, not as human beings, but how great their position is, how great their title is, how great where, you know, wherever they kind of have more clout than someone else. And this did not happen just one time. Jesus is only with these guys 3 years. And again, in this particular occasion, he has dismissed the crowds and he's only talking to the 12. And however long he taught, Jesus is a master teacher. But at the end of the course, they go, well, I don't really get what he said, but here's a better topic anyway. Well, then, to make matters worse, it continues into the next chapter. But this time, it involves one of their mothers. This is like reality TV before there was such a thing. Enter Mrs. Zebedee. She essentially comes on the scene to Jesus. She's got her two boys in tow. Jesus, when you come into your kingdom, she's envisioning a throne, big center throne, you know, like the emperor would have, and then a side throne on the right and a side throne on the left. And she says, Jesus, when you come into your kingdom, I want you to give my boys the position on the left and the position on the right. This is Mrs. Zebedee. And don't you understand a mom who wants good things for her kids? But she too is thinking one-dimensional success. She's not asking, Jesus, when you come into your kingdom, can you teach my boys how to actually be great people? Not just be great at something. She's not asking, Jesus, can you help them to actually live the way God wants them to live? She's saying, can you give them a good position? How many parents spend all of their money and time and energy to get their kids through school so that they'll get a good position? And they're not thinking about the posture that they need to have that's the better posture to actually succeed in the world the way God wants them to succeed, which is a posture on our knees first before God, recognizing that he's God and he's at the center and there needs to be less of self and more of him. But she's not thinking in those terms. Well, word gets back to the other 10. I love this. When the 10 heard about this, they became indignant with James and John. And I do not think that they were thinking how ashamed they were at their fellow teammates for behaving in this manner. I think they were mad because those two and their mother thought about it first. That they're mad that these two pulled the mom card on Jesus and they didn't do it first. And so now again, there's this posturing and this arguing, and here's how Jesus responds. It's very similar the first time as well as the second, but I'll read the second time. Verse 42, and Jesus called them to him and he said to them, you know that those who are considered rulers over the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them, but not so among you. Whoever would, what are the next two words? Be great among you must be your servant. And whoever would be first among you must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man, talking about Jesus himself, came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. Here is the God revelation today that I want to get to every one of us, including myself, that rather than pride and posturing and positioning, the measure of greatness is learned when we leverage more time, talents, and resources for the benefit of others and the advancement of God's kingdom. It's when we learn to leverage that. Self-seeking will take you only so far. What God says outlasts everything, because 1 Corinthians talks about a kind of love that just doesn't quit, it doesn't end, it keeps on believing, it keeps on going, it has enduring power, it has lasting power to it. If you want to know what goes the distance, then it's not about self-seeking, it's about self-surrender. It's about serving others and serving and giving. And Jesus uses himself as the example to say the best picture of the Son of Man or the Son of God, Jesus himself, the best picture is that he came to serve and to give his life. This is why Jesus would also come along and say, to whom much is given, much is required. This is why the word leverage is so good, because God's not asking you to actually give away everything that he's put in your hands. What he wants you to do is learn how to leverage it for his advancement of his kingdom. That we would learn to leverage it. So yes, some of it you enjoy. Some of it you have to use to actually live where God's called you to live. But then you don't just make it about yourself and your kingdom and your family and what you can get out of it and what you can pass on to the next generation of your family, but how you can advance the kingdom of God with your lifestyle and with your livelihood while you're alive to leverage things for God. I want to tell every single person listening to me today, you have a call of God on your life. Whether you know him yet or not, God has called you. He has made you and then called you for a significant purpose in this world. And your contribution is not supposed to be fulfilled by someone else. Neither are you supposed to envy everybody else and want their contribution. God has unique things for you, and the posture of self-sacrifice where we lay down our rights and our ambitions and we surrender them to God for him to resurrect them in a fashion where we leverage them for a greater purpose than just our own is what makes your life become what God intended it to be. It's a whole different way to live, but it's the better way to live. Now, on a practical level, some of it happens inside the walls of a church. So we have life group fair going on right now. We really do want everyone to get into a life group because we believe that there's revelation that can happen on the weekend, but there's great growth that can happen in groups. That God can give you aha moments in these kind of environments, but God can give you iron sharpening iron when two people talk with one another and people pray for one another and they celebrate your high times and they're with you in the low times. But can I remind you of this? There's no group that happens if everyone is just an attendee and there's no people leading. We need leaders and co-leaders. We need people who realize that God has gifted you to actually serve someone else, that you can go into a group, you can open up your heart, but you might be the one that opens up your home. that God's given you these homes in the Bay Area or wherever you may live, and they're not just for you to sleep in and eat in. Perhaps they're for you to break bread in with other believers, where your home is open and you're the host home, or you're the co-leader because you don't feel yet qualified to lead, but you know what you can do? You can come along the leader and say, I'd be willing to help you. Wherever you need help, I will be here to serve you. Some of you need to find a leader and say, I will serve you. That posture of leader, that posture of servanthood will help you learn how to lead God's way. We need people to become kingdom builders. We have life groups that are called kingdom builder groups. They're 6 weeks long. It helps you understand your purpose out in the marketplace, that it's not just to make a living. And so how do you make a difference? And how do you leverage your resources? And how do you think differently? We need people that have faith to actually go through a group for 6 weeks and say, that's what I wanna sign up for. I wanna actually be a kingdom builder the rest of my life. I don't wanna build my kingdom. I want to advance his. It's a different way to think. And so we can do things inside the walls of church, but I want to one more time say, this message is not just for what happens inside the walls of church. Can I tell you, those of you that are parents, and we felt the great burden of this, the great responsibility when our kids were younger, that it was primarily our job to model in front of our kids authentic faith, the attitudes that God wanted us to have. And part of it is this, that we would illustrate to them what it means to serve God's kingdom, not just ours. Not just because we are pastors, but because we are followers of Jesus. And we wanted our kids to know that God's kingdom is first, not ours. We make him first. We put him at the center. Self-seeking is when you're at the center. But we tried to tell our kids in many different ways, God is at the center of our home. God is at the center of our marriage. God is at the center of how we think and what we're supposed to do. And of course, we were imperfect parents, but we would keep coming back to the perfect word and the perfect Savior. And we would offer them a relationship with Jesus themselves. If you adopt the methodology of the world, you'll parent like the world thinks, and your kids will put themselves in the center, and they will think entitlement, and they will chase happiness. And happiness is a dead end street when you chase after it. There's nowhere in scripture that God says chase after happiness. It's chase after his spirit. Chase after him. Happiness comes and goes like the wind. You have it sometimes and you don't have it others. But that's not what makes life rich anyway. Your significance in Christ is what makes life rich. And when you chase after something that was never to be chased, it cannot produce in you what you want it to produce. How is it that we apparently have more people chasing after happiness today, and yet anxiety and depression and perhaps even suicide are at all-time highs? Because the world cannot produce the outcomes of God's kingdom. All it can do is promise big and deliver little. And it does it time and time again. So if you're a parent, the stakes are higher on this. That you put God first in your money, and you put God first in your mouth, and you put God first in your time, and you don't make it about your conveniences, you make it about your convictions and about his kingdom. For those of you that are brand new today, I didn't want to leave you out, because I understand all of us have a starting point in this. And this is so counterintuitive, but at some point, you know what God wants from you? Just your trust, just your faith. And God gave you enough faith to believe in him. There's not a person on this planet that wasn't given a deposit of faith to believe that there is a God and that there is a Savior and his name is Jesus. And they might not always know his name. I have heard stories of missionaries that people, they came into to different areas of the world and people were basically serving Jesus without yet knowing his name. The Holy Spirit revealed himself to them. There's faith that you can reach out today and say, I need to live the better life. And the better life is not when I put myself at the center. The better life is when I put the God who made me at the center. And so today is about you just surrendering your life to Jesus and start the journey with him. But if you're already a follower of Jesus, can I remind you something that's coming up on the calendar? And in some ways, we would call it the real Super Bowl of Sunday. It's called Easter. All right, Easter is like the Super Bowl of all Sundays. And it's only 7 weeks away. And in between now and then, I think there's things that can happen. And here's kind of my contention. This is different for every person. Some of you will get there in 2 years, and some it might take a little longer than five, but I'll just say five Easters. Once you come to church five Easters, you don't come to Easter anymore for yourself. You come for somebody else. Because you already know what we're gonna talk about, right? We're gonna talk about the death and resurrection of Jesus, again, on Easter, because it's important and we need to. But you don't now come to Easter and hope, well, I hope this sermon was better than last year's sermon, or you know, I hope they do something creative, I hope they sing the songs. That's you being self-serving. You gotta grow out of that and at some point say, I'm coming to the Super Bowl with my friends. I'm inviting some people. So right now, start praying about the people you could invite, because you don't just come to Easter service, you come bringing. You come bringing, and those of you that are online, you're not off the hook. It's like open your house up to some people, promise them the biggest, best barbecue the neighborhood is putting on, but it's at your house, but they have to watch the Easter service first. Figure out how to leverage, come on. The stakes are too high for us to go week after week after week and not think strategic. My name is Doug. And I'm your friend. Some of you will have to go back a few weeks in some of our sermons to know what I'm talking about, but I'm here to call you higher. The job of the church is to cause people to walk in their holy calling. And so we serve and we give. Let me talk to the servers for a minute. When it comes to Easter, first of all, I wanna just take a moment here and applaud all those who serve week in and week out. So, and then I wanna highlight this. The applause of your peers are not nearly as great as the applause of heaven, because I believe if heaven applauds the one that was lost but it's found, heaven also applauds when the found people start finding their purpose through serving. I think there's applause of heaven. And so I wanna commend your serving, but I also wanna say this about Easter. It's the Super Bowl. You don't, if you're on the team, you don't sit down. You don't wanna sit in the stands on Easter, and you don't wanna even sit on the bench. You wanna play as many minutes of the game as possible. So if you serve on regular weeks, when it comes to Easter, serve twice as much. Serve three times as much. Start 2 or 3 weeks early, finding ways to serve. And ask some of the pastoral team, ask your campus pastors, how can I serve the house? How can I help us get ready? What can I do? There's a lot of things to do. I'll also say this, I wanna encourage you to pre-give before Easter gets here, like an extra offering. I did a thing and we had an emphasis in November and it went into December, and it was a call to give and just believe that God wanted us to do something. And I wanna say two things about that. First of all, thank you for those of you that have participated. We did have a nice percentage and some good things happened. And so I commend you. But I'm also strategic in saying we had a nice percentage, because we didn't have what we should have had. I believe, just as a pastor, I need to be honest with you and tell you, we fell far short of the amount of participation that I believe the potential of our church has. And for that reason, I also have to call our church to say, don't make it about money. It's not about that. It's about what you can invest in the kingdom of God, because you got before God and you said, what's the part I should play? What should I do? And too many people honestly sat on the sidelines and heard it all and plotted it and said, go for it, Pastor. We have things to do on both of our campuses to get ready for Easter, and we don't have the resources that we'd love to have to be able to do that. We have mailers that we want to put out to our community, but we feel like some of it just needs to be on hold right now because we just don't want to presume before we have people saying to us, "Pastor, go for it." I use the phrase status quo. That I felt like we were kind of at a status quo. You know, everything's fine. We'd have no crisis. There's no big there's no big drama. There's no fire going. There's none of that. But I felt like we were living in a constrained time when I wanted the people of God to operate in greater faith, not fear. And I believe fear still has a hook in the Bay Area, especially relative to finances. Can I tell you the God of the Bay Area? It's called Mammon. Now that's money, for all of you that don't know, kind of that's a phrase in the Bible, but money is the God of the Bay Area. And so the people of God have to slay the God of the area before God does in that area what God wants to do. And so we have to think strategic about this. So I'll just say one more time, my name is Doug and I'm your friend. And I don't want you to get to the end of the journey having fallen below your potential. I'm calling you to faith. I'm calling you higher. I am calling you to serve and give because that's what our Savior did. And he did it again and again and again. It wasn't one time on the cross. Our Savior has been serving and giving to us ever since he rose again from the dead. Now, in a few moments, we're going to celebrate communion together. What better way to remind ourselves of this message than to remind ourselves that on the night that Jesus was crucified, he first gathered with his disciples in an upper room. And at some point, he wrapped a towel around himself and he grabbed a basin of water and he washed their dirty, stinky feet. None of them listened to his sermons and his teaching about servant leadership all the way up to that point. I think finally there was an aha moment when they saw the Savior get down on his knees and do what servants did. Went all the way around the room, including Judas. Come on. Washed the feet of the one who would betray him. Then he would get up and he would go into a garden and he would pray, "Father, not my will, but yours." Jesus putting the will of the Father at the center, not his own conveniences and comfort. Then he goes to the cross and he hangs on the cross for the sins of the world, which include my sins and your sins and everyone else's sins. And who's glad that Jesus paid the price for our sin, and when payment was complete, he was able to say, "It is finished, paid in full." Anybody glad that your sin was paid in full on the cross by Jesus because he's serving and giving? And so I want to pray over us today because I believe that the spirit of this world does not want any one of us to apply anything we heard today. I'm going to pray for ears to hear what the Holy Spirit is saying. I'm gonna pray for hearts to be open to say the word got in there, but it's not gonna get snatched away because that's another analogy of the Bible, that it got there, the seed got there, but then the ways of the world just kind of took over and snatched it away. I'm gonna pray that it'll be the kind of word that does not return void, but it accomplishes what God wants it to. So Jesus, for my friends listening online, for those in Alamo, for those here in Dublin, for those that will be listening to this even in this upcoming week or the weeks ahead, I pray for ears to hear what the Spirit of God is saying to his church. If Paul were here today, I wonder what words he would have written to us. He wrote some interesting words to the Corinthian people that needed to come down to our generation. We certainly still live in a self-serving generation. But sometimes that mentality winds up in the church and we just come to church week after week and we're still asking it to be about us. If the church could just serve me, if they could just do it and Jesus, I understand all that. I understand how people have a starting point, but I'm praying for revelation that people would have a new revelation of where the greatest satisfaction in life comes, and that's when they put your kingdom ahead of their own. when they say, not my will, but yours. When they one more time say, I surrender all. When they take communion with a new revelation that it wasn't just about what you did, but it's what you want us to model. I pray right now for those that need to commit their lives to Christ. If that's you today listening online or in Alamo or Dublin, and you don't have a relationship with Jesus or you feel far from God, right now just tell him, I need you in my life. I want to put you at the center. I ask you to forgive me. Thank you for doing for me what I couldn't do on my own. I couldn't take care of my sin, but you paid for it on a cross. I'm hearing that maybe for the first time, and I believe that something inside me said that was for me. That's God loving me. And I want to receive all the love of God that you have for me. So Jesus, come into my life and be my Savior and my Lord. And then for all the rest of us, as we go into communion in a few moments, I pray that we would not only celebrate what you did, but we would commit to why you did it and what you want us to do. I pray that in Jesus' name.